Today, we're talking about technology, and I think all of you recognize, no matter whether you're a grandparent, community member, elementary parent, you probably recognize that Greater La Trobe has been a leading district on the use of technology since the early 90s, actually, a very long time ago. One of the first districts across the state to actually do a one-to-one laptop program in the junior high school, I might add. And we're going to take one of the old laptops to the Historical Society because it weighs about 50 pounds. That was a combat version for junior high school students. But one of the common threads throughout all of the technology history of Greater La Trobe is this person right here. Dr. Pinus has been a business education teacher in the district, I won't give a start date, for many years. She also has served as director of technology for many years, and in the middle of that was a principal actually at Mountain View for a few years. But since I've been here, she has been the director of technology, and honestly, there have been so many upgrades in technology in the district that you may not see. You know, they're not visible, not something that your student carries around with you, but a lot of infrastructure upgrades that have been tremendously beneficial to our educational programming, instructional methods, and so on. It really has been tremendous, especially in the last 8 years. And that truly is a credit to the leadership that Dr. Pinus has had with us in technology. In addition, as you're probably aware, the school board has really, obviously, been embedded with the process of the use of technology and instruction and learning. And that is historic. Obviously, back in the 90s, that was a huge risk, probably, if you want to call it that, from the point of spending taxpayer money for technology. But I think back then they recognized the impact this was going to have on education and public education in particular. We have a cyber charter school within Greater La Trobe. It's called ECATS. That is something that was promoted by the principals as well as Dr. Pinus maybe 6 years ago now. You know, you hear administrators such as myself and school board members complaining a lot about cyber charter schools, private cyber charter schools within the state that take our students, and I use that term take literally, and we are billed for those students to go there. And they choose to go there for a lot of different reasons, but what we have allowed and been instrumental in doing through Dr. Pinus' leadership is really developing courses that our students can go full-time, K-12, if they choose to, and I said charter, it's not a program within our district, I apologize. But it is a program that if a student wants to go full-time K-12, they can, as well as if they want to do some part-time courses. If they're homeschooled, they can take some courses and so on. So it's really been a benefit to our community, and it has decreased the number of students who choose to go to private cyber charter schools. Do we still have some? Absolutely, we still do. And I don't know that we'll ever get down to zero, but we do have far less. So before I take any questions, if you have any questions at any time, please ask. But Dr. Pinus is going to do a little presentation on social media.
Well, first of all, I want to thank you all for being here today. I appreciate you coming out and participating. This is exciting stuff for me. This is the world I live in, so the things I like to talk about and things that I like to do as part of my job. You've been given a little piece of paper that has a plenty shape on it. For now, you can just set that aside or keep it on your lap. We can get to a point in the presentation where you'll be using that, and I'll explain what you need to do with it when we get there. So today, talk a little bit about social media and technology gives ideas. Talk about being match made in heaven, right? So we'll segue probably with a little bit of a break in between the two, because trying to tie that together proved to be a little bit difficult with the smooth transition. So we'll talk about the social media piece, and then we'll break into the holiday gift ideas. One of the things I want to mention before I begin is social media is such a broad topic, and it's almost hard to really cover in really great detail in a presentation like this. So this by no means is meant to be comprehensive, but I did want to talk about some of the main things with social media, specifically how it relates to your kids, and just maybe some things you can look out for. So we'll go ahead and get started. So the first thing, just to make sure we're all kind of starting at the same level, is what is social media? And social media essentially is defined as a computer-mediated technology that allows not only individuals, but now companies, corporations, businesses, the like, to view, create, and share information. And it's becoming extremely widespread. And I'm going to show you a little bit about social media and some of the statistics. So I looked up some statistics on social media in general, not necessarily related to teens, but just in general. And these are actually 2016 statistics, so they're fairly recent. And I put at the top for context, just so you can kind of grasp the significance of some of the numbers. The total world population in 2015 was 7.3 billion. So the first statistic you look at is the internet has 3.17 billion users worldwide. So that accounts for about 43% of our population. And when you think about that from a population perspective, I hope I'm not making anybody sick with my... I should tell you, if you get motion sickness, you might want to close your eyes in between each click of the screen. So when you think about 3.17 billion users as it compares to 7.3 population, you're talking about babies, you're talking about elderly, you're talking about third world countries, you're talking about worldwide. I think that's pretty significant. Of the 3.17 internet users, 2.3 billion of those are active social media users. That accounts for about 43%. So of all the people that use the internet, about 43% are active social media users. So again, pretty astounding. Businesses. 91% of retail brands use two or more social media channels. I'm sure you've seen in the news, airlines are notorious for it, right? Somebody will tweet something out about a bad flight, and immediately the airline will respond with a comment or a fix or something. Businesses have social media accounts for their products, so most businesses are using these. Okay, quick pop quiz. You don't have to shout out an answer. Maybe just think of something in your mind. What's the average number of social media accounts you think each user has? Anyone throw me a guess? What do you think?
Two?
Okay, ready? 5.54. Seems like a lot, doesn't it? When you think about it though, and you start going through what's considered social media and the different accounts people use, I think that probably is about right. Social media use is on the rise. Last year, it's up by 176 million users. There's 1 million new active mobile, so key word there, mobile social media users added every day. That's 12 each second. And basically mobile, meaning they're not doing it from a desktop at home, probably more than likely on their phone, a tablet, maybe even a laptop. And Facebook Messenger and WhatsApp handle 60 billion messages a day. Now, these are apps that you put on a phone or on a tablet that you can use to message people, very much like your phone text message. If you've ever taken your phone, you get from Verizon or Sprint, and you have the text message app that's built into that. These are actually apps that you can use. It basically has the same functionality, but these might relate more to Facebook if you have an account on Facebook, or just maybe provides a little bit more features than the general text messaging that your internet service or cell phone provider provides. So again, as a point of comparison, that's 3 times the number of just regular cell phone SMS messages exchanged every day. So that's huge. Okay, so that's just some basic, broad information on social media. I wanted to kind of set the framework for how much this impacts us and why probably telling your kids they can't use it isn't really an option, right? It's the world they live in. It's really the world we live in. So we have to find a way to manage it. Okay, so now we're going to do a little quiz, okay? This is where your papers come into play. It'll take me just a minute. I got to jump out of my presentation here. But if you look at your paper, you'll see on the front of it, at the top of each edge of your block, there's a letter. And they might be a little hard to see, so I actually wrote them on the back, too, so that they would, that it would correspond. And what you want to do is I'm going to flash up a question. And you're going to hold up your shape with the letter at the top of whatever answer you think it is, from A, B, C, or D, okay? And you want to hold this part toward me, and that's why I wrote the letters on the back, so you don't have to kind of look at the front and try to guess, because I know those letters are really small. So just give me 1 second here, I can jump out of this. And this is something called clickers, and it's a great tool even to be used in classrooms, in which teachers can immediately gauge how students are responding to questions and whether or not they know content. Okay, so we're going to do a little quiz. How well do you recognize your social media icons? This first one is probably a give me. I just did it just to see. And help you when you're answering your first question. So, the icon you see up there, what do you recognize that as? A, my friend, B, Facebook, C, FaceTime, or D, Flirty? Hold your answers up, and then what I'm going to do is scan, and you'll see as I go through, you'll see your answers kind of populate up there. You can kind of set this so you can know, you can actually assign these cards. There's actually little numbers on them that you can assign them. So if you're using this in a classroom, you can actually identify which students. Now, each other students don't know. So it's a great way for kids to be able to answer, right? And not be afraid of being wrong. But for you guys, I kept you all anonymous, so don't worry about that. Okay, so everybody says it's B. Let's see, reveal the answer. Yay, yes, it's B. The next one. Some of these might get a little bit trickier now. Maybe not this one. Okay, what do you think about this one? Let's get the graph up. Recognize this icon. This is probably another fairly popular one. And I'm just scanning this. There's a camera option inside of this app. And what it's doing really is it's just reading your blocks. And so your blocks are just built in a certain way to recognize which letter they represent. Okay, everybody says D, Twitter. Drum roll. Yep. D, Twitter. Alright. We only have a couple more of these. Okay, how this one? This one might be a little bit trickier, huh? I don't know. We'll see. Anybody know what this one represents? Actually used this with the kids, and I'll talk a little bit more about a presentation I did earlier in the year. And so I used this with a group of ninth graders and sophomores, I guess, that we were doing an orientation on. And they actually really liked it. Okay, so let's see. Oh, you guys are actually pretty good.
What kinds of objects are you using this now in class?
This actual tool?
Yeah.
Maybe not this specifically. We actually do, as a district, provide every one of our classroom teachers with what we call student response system.
I think kids get that.
And it's actually a similar thing. The nice thing about that is the teachers are able to build in a lot more information about the students when they're doing it, still keeping it anonymous. And then the kids just have, instead of pulling out slides, they actually just have clippers they can put the answer into. So it's the same concept. But this one's just nice in an audience like this. It's just easier with a piece of paper. But yeah, we do have this type of instructional piece actually available in every one of our classrooms. We got them whenever we did the whiteboards. Okay. This one, I'll be curious to see on this one. How many of you know? Think about that for a second. Throw up an answer. Honestly, nobody's going to know how to answer.
I think you made this up, Dr.
You think? Interesting. I will show you I did not. This is what I am personally familiar with. Oh, wow. What's the variation in that one?
You're all guessing.
You're all guessing. All right, let's see. You ready? Okay. Yeah. The social media app is actually more common at the college level, and I'm going to talk a little bit about it, but that doesn't mean you might not see it. Okay, and for any of you who might have college-age kids, it's definitely something to be aware of. It's on one of my apps to watch list.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know I was only doing this one, huh? So, yeah, 3, uh-huh. Oh, wow. Glad to see this. Actually, I'm glad to see this, and I'm going to, again, explain a little bit more in presentation why, but overwhelmingly, yep, you guys got it. That is the very popular Snapchat. Okay, I think I have one more on social media. And then we'll get back to the presentation. How about this one? Kind of tricky with starting everything with a B, so you know it starts with a B. Is being used, and in particular among our kids. So those are popular types. So, social media pros and cons. We're going to talk a little bit about that. Social media is a great tool. You can communicate in ways that you could never communicate with people before. You can reach individuals at a level that you could never reach before. But there's also downsides to it. And because there's downsides to it, doesn't mean it's something that we shouldn't continue to use or promote. It just means, like anything, there's always a good with a bad. And you have to learn how to use it responsibly and manage your use of it. But I think anybody here would agree that the reach that you get and the information that you're able to provide to people through social media is just incredible. I know last week or the week before, we had posted some information about a student who got a little bit frightened on her way to school. And we had posted that up and got a lot of responses and people sharing it. And we would have never been able to put that type of information out before without this type of a tool. So it's got a lot of great uses, but you really need to balance it. I'm going to talk a little bit about the more negative stuff, but I just want you to keep it into perspective as well. It's like anything. There are car accidents every day, right, that people get killed, but that doesn't mean you don't ever drive, and it doesn't mean you don't teach our kids how to drive. So I see social media being a lot the same way. We have to teach our kids, really, how to use social media and how to use it responsibly. And so that's sort of the next part of the presentation. So here's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about social media and teens in particular. We're going to talk about things you really need to know. And we're going to talk about a few things that you really need to know right now when it comes to social media apps. And then I'm going to explain a little bit about what we do as a district to help educate students and teach responsible use. And then I'm going to also provide you with some options of what you can do as a parent. Okay, so social media in and of itself is popular. We established that. It's popular among really all age groups. But specifically speaking of teens, what do you think is the most popular social media app used by teens? One more question on our clickers here. Let me jump out because I'm really curious to see your response to this question. Here's the other thing I will tell you. Recent survey, this was done this year. Okay, this is a 2016 survey. What I will also tell you is the answer to this is different than what it was in 2015. So right now, 2016, what do you think is the most popular social media app being used by our kids right now?
This is Snapchat. It's a messaging app that lets users send disappearing texts, pictures, and videos. Teens love it because they can share silly moments, add colorful captions and graphics to their pictures, and set a timer for how many seconds these can be viewed. Some teens may even be tempted to share sexy images. After all, they're supposed to disappear, right? Well, not quite. It's easy to snap snaps. You can either take a screenshot or a photo of the message, or use other apps to capture snaps. Another issue, Snapchat's default setting lets anyone send you snaps. It's a good idea to change it to friends only. Then there's Discover, a Snapchat feature that's becoming harder to avoid. It serves up everything from news to, of course, marketing. For more advice on the latest social media app, visit us at commonsense.org.
Commonsense.org is actually a website I'm going to be sharing with you toward the end. It's a phenomenal site with a wealth of information. And so I'm going to actually pull it up, and I'm going to show you some key features of it and talk a little bit about our relationship with Common Sense Media as a district. But that is Snapchat. And the scary part about Snapchat is that all the information disappears, or so the students think, right? Whenever they send the information. So there is that temptation to send really inappropriate information because it's going to disappear. But you always do have the ability to screenshot. How many of you recall seeing the story about the IEP student last year that was in the news? She had sent an inappropriate Snapchat out to her friends, right? They're all your friends. Do you remember that one? And somebody screenshotted it before it disappeared, and it made national news. Let's just leave it at that. It made national news because of her comment in what she thought was just a disappearing private message. And so kids really need to understand the ramifications when they are posting information, even what they feel is what is a private environment. When it's digital, there's nothing private about it at all. There's nothing private, and it is all permanent. And that's what they really, really need to understand. I will tell you, I still old school text on my phone with my Verizon text app. My daughter never uses her text messaging app. Every bit of communication is through Snapchat. And that's, again, that's a scary part. But again, I work to educate, just like we do all of our kids, about the use of that. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. So when it comes to social media and these apps that kids are using, and the other thing I want to mention, I'm sorry, just to backtrack just a little bit on Snapchat, one of the things they mentioned in the video is about the new promotions they're doing on it. Did you see the Food Network? So not only do you have new apps being developed all the time, but you have the current apps that we have constantly changing. So, you know, it's something that's difficult to keep up with, but you really have to be proactive in how you deal with it. I know at least in Apple iTunes and Google Play, those are two of the biggest app stores. There's over a million apps available. There are 60,000 new ones every month. 60,000 new ones every month. And of course, that is the direction and the shift that the whole technology, internet, even now, laptop operating system shift is coming with apps. So a couple things just to kind of segue off of this just a little bit, just so you can kind of again understand the direction of technology and the use of apps, not just social media, but apps in general. Two things noted just recently. One is more people access the internet through mobile devices, okay, than they do desktops. And if you probably think about your own, you should probably go, oh yeah, you might use a desktop at work, you should probably have a desktop at home, you might have replaced it with a tablet or maybe a laptop. So more people are accessing the internet through mobile devices than they are on, you know, stationary machines. But the second part, which actually occurred, they call it a tipping point, shortly after that.
like a direct URL on a web browser. So I'm sure you're all familiar with Chrome and Internet Explorer, Firefox, and it used to be Netscape Navigator. How many of you remember that one way back in the day? Okay? More people are accessing information through apps than they are going through a straight URL. So apps are really where everything is headed. Windows' latest operating system was built, I believe it was 10, on the basis of being able to use apps now on your laptop instead of just on a mobile device. So apps are constantly changing. There are more things that fit people's needs, and they're constantly being developed and generated. And my point in mentioning that is, again, just to kind of reiterate with you, that what's popular now may not be what's popular in 6 months or 12 months, because it's a moving target. And so one of the things that we try to talk to our kids about with their social media use is protecting their digital footprint. How many of you have ever heard that term before, digital footprint? And so it's about protecting what they do online, because it's something that's always going to be with them. And that's why it becomes extremely important. I have a short little video here that just explains a little bit more about what...
So if they're allowed to ask you in an interview yet, I mean, that's scary.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And if you think about that, right, you may say, well, that's my business. Well, it might be, but I think a business who's looking to hire you as a potential employee might think that's very much their business too. And I guess from my perspective, I would think, well, you don't have anything to hide, right? Why would you? That's kind of how bad you have the job. So yeah, that is very interesting. Very interesting. So obviously, social media makes a statement about who we are. We've got colleges checking, we've got employers checking. I always tell the kids, I told them this in a presentation at the beginning of the year, their teachers check it. They see it, they know, they see. So you need to be very careful of that digital footprint. Okay, so those are some things about what you need to know. Now let's get into a few other things. Maybe the not so nice side of social media and some of the things that you really need to know right now. So one of the things are what are called hidden or ghost apps. Any of you ever hear that term or know what that's referencing? Yeah. Unfortunately, it's not a real nice concept. And just to give you a little bit of information, this was from a fairly recent Today Show episode, and again, I have the link underneath it. This was from a study in 2012, although they were reporting on it just recently, but this was the most recent study they had. So think about how scary that statistic is from 2012 and where you think that number might actually be now. So in 2012, a study found that more than 70% of teens have hidden online activity from their parents. Now, we have what are called hidden or ghost apps. So basically, it's kind of two different things, or there's two different ways it can be done. A hidden app can be something like an app that appears to be something else, right? But then when you actually open the app, it actually is something completely different. Probably one of the most infamous ones is this calculator app. So you all need to run home and check the kid's cell phone for the calculator app. The calculator app appears to be a regular calculator, and in some cases when you click on it, it actually does front as a working calculator, but when you unlock it, it's actually a place where they can hide pictures. So if you take their phone and you say, oh, I'm going to run through your camera roll just to see what you have, you go, oh, that's great, you don't have anything here that's inappropriate. Yeah, why? Because I might have them all hidden in their calculator app where you don't see them. So kids are very smart and savvy at using these kinds of tools. The other thing, ghost apps are apps that allow you to exchange information, but in a way that it keeps it secret. So probably the two biggest ways I see these hidden and ghost apps used is to hide pictures and then to hide texting, right? So if they're communicating with someone and they don't want you to see their conversations, obviously Snapchat, they disappear. Regular SMS, text message, you can always see your history. But if for some reason they want to retain that conversation, maybe with a boyfriend, girlfriend, or with a exact group, or, you know, just sentimental value, they can hide those conversations with what are called ghost apps, so that there's a special way you have to unlock it in order to be able to see that information. Here are four of them that I think are fairly popular, but honestly, by no means are they the most popular, maybe, and there's probably a ton more. In fact, you can actually go out onto, let me just do it for you real quick here. Many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with iTunes because that's the Apple Play Store. Chrome actually also has, or Google actually has one called Google Play. And if I search, and I can actually just search hidden apps, and these are all kinds of apps that will come up that will show.
I'm so sorry.
different hidden apps that can be used and how they're disguised and what they're for. The one I think I showed you on the preview screen actually fronts as an audio manager control, so you might think it's something for speakers. So very, very easy to find is my point. Just go to the App Store and just say hidden apps, and it will show you what they are. This is the one I was just referencing. Looks like a little music app, doesn't it? You saw that on your kid's phone, you probably wouldn't think anything of it. So those are a couple things you need to be aware of. The other thing is what are called anonymous apps. And anonymous apps are scary because for most apps, think about it, Snapchat, you have to be friends with somebody, right? When you're snapping somebody, you have to have made that connection through typically a username of some sort. You don't just snap out to the world. You can snap out to all the people that you are friends with. You can snap out to an individual user that's in your friend group. But the reality of it is, it's not like a Twitter where it can go out everywhere. So to some degree, there's a little bit of protection, even with Facebook, right? Because you have to friend somebody, and so you kind of know who they are with your username. But these apps are what are called anonymous apps. And they're scary because they're apps that you're able to get on, and you don't have to friend somebody with a username. So you can actually be talking to strangers and somebody who's presenting them. I kind of equate this to the old chat rooms, right? The kids used to be involved in. That you could, somebody could front as somebody else, and your kids could end up talking to them. This is sort of like a newer version of those chat rooms. And so I don't know, I'm going to break out of this presentation zoom in on some of these just to show you. How many of you remember, it was in the news fairly recently, the little 13-year-old girl that was killed by two Virginia Tech students? Virginia Tech students, okay, I think they were both engineering majors. They met that little 13-year-old on Kik Messenger, and that's how they were communicating with her. Agreed to meet with her, and then of course ended up, this is her actually down. Anybody remember seeing that in the news? Yeah. Maybe it was in the last year or so. Okay, that was Kik Messenger. You may hear your kids talk about that. It's a messaging app. But the danger and difficulty of it, different like a Snapchat, which believe me has its own issues because that stuff disappears. But with Snapchat, like I said, there's got to be a connection that's already been established. Kik just allows you to talk to anybody, and that's where people will make those acquaintances. Here's another one. Ask FM. I will tell you, we have personal experience with FM, Ask FM here in the district. We have kids that use this, okay, because it's been reported to us about comments that have been made. It's also an anonymous app, and it's an app that somebody can go out, use somebody's name, say something really awful about them, and you can't tell who said it. It's not traced back to anything other than a basic username that anybody can just create. Again, it's not tied back to a Snapchat user. Here's an incident just recently of a student who actually committed suicide because he was being so attacked on AskFM. Because his mother wouldn't let him play Call of Duty. And so kids were teasing him about being a baby. And so his mother just recently wrote an open letter to the bullies, right? Because she doesn't necessarily know who they were. So she wrote an open letter to them about how their words on AskFM actually drove her son to commit suicide. Here's an even scarier part. If you can read what I have highlighted, if not, I'll read it. One of the websites he was targeted on was AskFM, which has been linked to 7 teenage suicides. So these people targeted him just in these hateful, hateful ways and essentially drove this boy to commit suicide. So that's one we've had personal experience with. I'll say a couple years
You may be
like I said, it was on probably most of the girls' Instagrams.
As a district, unfortunately, we've dealt with these situations more often than you would probably even think, and you would be surprised.
And it's not the girl's fault. I mean, she has this account, but since it's anonymous, I mean, it's, you know, who knows who posted it?
Right.
But it was nasty.
Right. Yes. Oh, I know. Believe me. Like, I've read some stuff. I've had to get through investigations, and I'm shocked. And I think to myself, these aren't things somebody would say to someone's face. Why would you say it through social media? Because you can, right? Because it's anonymous. And so to some degree, it gives you that level of protection. But doesn't make it right, right? And so again, it's something we really need to talk to our kids about in terms of how their words may impact others. And this is the last one. You ready for this? When you think about sexting. Oh, wait, here. I got one more on here. This is one I told you earlier I was going to talk about. Yeah. See, it really is an app. I didn't just make that up. Here's what I'll tell you. This is very big on the college scene. Doesn't mean that it might not become more popular at this level, but it's an interesting app. Like, I admire it to some degree. It's pretty, pretty creative. It's location-based, right? So college kids love this because you can be sitting in your dorm room and just randomly throw out a question to really anybody that's on that app in your area and start a conversation or just talk about what's going on. One of the things, my daughter had a personal experience with this. If you look down here to this one, it says, shout out to the girl in the red sweater on the library steps. So it's so location-based, right? You can be walking into an area, if you're on your app, you can see that people are talking about you, right? As you're maybe entering a room. My daughter, the one day, had gone into the cafeteria of Penn State. She had a particular color shirt on, and she tripped, and somebody made a comment, and she doesn't know if it really was about her, but she felt like it was, and it made her feel very uncomfortable and awkward. So that's what they're dealing with now. Think about it. I mean, back in the day, kids would maybe whisper and talk about you, but you didn't necessarily know it or hear it, right? Now kids have this in their face all the time. All the negativity, all the criticism, all the comments are constantly coming at you. And I think it's hard for us as adults to deal with that. I think it's even harder for kids to deal with that. I gotta tell you, I feel for these kids nowadays and what they have to deal with social media. And that's why I think it's so key and so paramount that we really just have to keep reaching out to these kids about how their words on social media, just like their words face-to-face can be hurtful, that their words on social media can be just as hurtful. Okay, now the next one, sexting. Before I show the slide, you might have already seen it. How many girls do you think have done this? Give me a percentage or a number. Do you think it's widespread? I think a lot of girls have done it. One in five. That's pretty staggering.
Is there any age with that one?
Teens. And so I think the range was probably like 13 to 17. And I'll be honest with you, I wanted to mention this when I started my presentation. I geared this a lot toward teens, but I wanted to also let you know that I'm using that term loosely because there are kids in fourth, fifth, and sixth grade using social media. So take the word
teens. So we have had a lot of fun.
Yes, we have. Yes, so take the word teen loosely, but in this particular study, I believe it's 13 to 17. 13 to 17. One in five is a new selfie. I did a presentation at the beginning of this year to our 9th and 10th graders on sexting. I think it was titled, What Do You Really Know About It? And I did it with our school resource officer, Rob Dare. And what I really tried to educate the kids on, because believe me, I know they all know what sexting is, and I told them that. Like,
all know what sexting is. I know you've probably seen it, you know about it, you know who does it. But how much do you know about the ramifications of it? And having Officer Beer there, we were able to talk to them about all the legal implications of a girl who sends a new picture willingly and the trouble that she can get into. And he had had this issue, learned way more about this topic than I probably cared to, in terms of what the picture shows, what the girl's doing, and the level of offenses that can be charged against a girl who willingly does it. I wanted to send my boyfriend a new picture, but guess what? At 14, you can't. From the law standpoint, you can't. It's pornography. And so we talked to them a little bit about that. So, did it make a difference? I don't know. My daughter told me everybody was scared when they left there that day. I said, well, I hope so. They should be, because you really shouldn't be doing this. Okay, so what do we do? Well, I just mentioned to you one of the things we do. We held an orientation at the beginning of this year. I'll jump down to the last one since I'm on that topic. Sexting, what do you really know about it? We gave it to all 9th and 10th graders. In that same context, they also rotated around to another presentation, all 9th and 10th graders, by Mr. Paremka and Ms. Sephora, called Your Words Matter, where they talked about that whole bullying aspect, relating it directly to social media and things that the kids are saying online. So that is definitely something that we do, that we really try to hone in on these kids about the importance of using social media responsibly. Not about not using it, right? Because that's unrealistic. It's about using it, but knowing how to use it responsibly. The other thing we do, we have curriculum built in our classrooms and through our library, which are our media specialists, using Common Sense Media Program. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that on the next screen. But Common Sense Media is a great site that we've partnered with that organization in educating our kids about really technology, digital literacy in general. We have a comprehensive district-wide bullying program, K-12. In fact, recently we did a presentation, it's actually on our website, and bullying isn't just the traditional face-to-face classroom bullying, but there's also the whole cyberbullying piece built into this, and so it runs the gamut on both facets of bullying, whether it's a face-to-face or whether it's online. We have school-wide positive behavior support programs in which we try to educate our students on how they should act with one another, both online and face-to-face, and promoting good, positive communication with people instead of negative. We also have various special programs throughout the district. I know St. Vincent College Prevention Program is one that we have. The Blackburn Center has a piece that comes in. And in addition to our orientation program, so we're really hitting these kids K-12 and with a variety of different media to try to get at them and continue to reinforce the importance of this. So you've heard me mention Common Sense. You've seen both videos I played did come from the Common Sense website. We are a certified Common Sense Digital Citizenship District. We're one of 5 districts in Pennsylvania that are certified. We're one of 40 in the United States that are certified. I put the percentages up there again, just so you can see the significance of that. So what is Common Sense Digital Citizenship? It's a plan of action that we have put in place in coordination with the site using their resources. It was a very rigorous process that we had to go through. There was a huge checklist of items. We had to have a plan. We had to determine how we were going to educate our kids. We even had to agree on the number of hours that we would provide them instruction on these topics. So it was a very, very rigorous process in terms of getting certified as a digital citizenship district, indicating that we're really working with our kids to inform them and educate them. And before I go on to the next part of this, I want to show you that site, because if you don't remember anything about this presentation, I want you to remember the site, because the site is going to give you a wealth of information. It has information about movies. You can key in one of the popular movies up at the movie theater right now, and it'll give you a rating. It'll tell you different levels about that movie. It'll give you a description of it. It'll tell you how much sex, how much violence, all of that information on it. It will review apps. If you want to know information on an app, key it in, search it out. Books, TV, games, websites, all of it. So it's a very, very comprehensive site. If you look here at the top, there's three tabs: parents, educators, and advocates. Okay, it defaults to the parent tab, and that's probably the one you're most interested in. But again, you can look at reviews, top picks. Here's one. You go to the parents tab, and parent concerns. This is a biggie right here. Facebook, Instagram, and social media. That's how it's titled, but obviously there's a lot more than just that information. But I wanted to show you, just like I showed you that video, what is Instagram? You can go on there and you can look up other videos. So if you come across an app, you can look to see if they have a review of it. They might even have a little video about what it is. So here's their whole social media site. There's a lot of parent information on here. 9 social media red flags parents should know about. I can't tell you enough about how great this site is and for the information and resources that you can find about social media, what to do, how to talk to your kid about it, warning signs, things you should be concerned about, all of that. So like I said, if you take nothing else from this presentation, at least take the use of that site with you, because it's fabulous. Okay, so that's what we do as a district. Now what can you do as a parent? Well, I would love to tell you that I can give you a magic answer, right? But clearly, I think you know from everything that we've talked about, the way this landscape is constantly changing, the tools that people put out there to make it even more difficult for you to find this information, there is no one magic bullet that's going to fix it all. I come up with a list of things. These are my things, not anybody else's, so take it for what it's worth, that I think you can do as a parent to help in this situation. So obviously the biggest one, be informed and be aware. If your kid's talking about an app or something that you've never heard of, or you can't name those icons or know what a social media app icon looks like, you need to educate yourself. And again, common sense is a great thing to do it on. Straight Google searches are awesome, right? Just what is this? Or, you know, why is this happening? You know, anything like that. Google is, this is my personal plug for Google, right? Their search engine of Chrome, is you can be so just generic about the way you type something. It doesn't have to be in any specific way. And you can type out a question, and it's gonna do a great job of kind of navigating and finding that answer for you. So be informed, be aware, whatever way you can. Actively seek out information. Try to find things just to kind of educate yourself and see what's going on. Obviously, monitor social media. Monitor your students' social media. See what they're putting out there, how they're talking online. Above all, I would know your child's passcode at any time. It would not be acceptable to me in my house that if I picked up a phone, I wasn't able to unlock it and see what you're doing. I always tell my daughter, I pay the bill on it, so technically it's mine, right? So that may or may not be the case with all kids, but I would know their passcode at a minimum. I'm not saying that you always have to creep on them. They should have that a level of understanding that you can pick their phone up at any time you want and be able to see it. And monitor your app downloads. So, for instance, kids can get these apps and they can hide them.
downloads as a purchased app. So you can monitor that through your app store purchases to know what apps your kids have downloaded and to know what they're using. So that's another place, great place to look at that you might not think about. So those are just a couple things that I came up with. Like I said, I would love to tell you there's an easy answer to this, but really, unfortunately, there isn't. So resources, there's tons of them. I only listed these four. The first one, for obvious reasons, I talked the whole way through about common sense and how wonderful I think their site is. These three in particular, I listed only because they were actually provided to me by state police resources. Their state police officer. So I kind of trust their judgment and what they're using and what they were able to provide. So that's why I put those ones up there as well. Are there more? Absolutely. You just have to go look for them and find them. But these are four that I felt very comfortable providing, which again provides tons of information about social media, checking your child's accounts, looking for that information. And again, I'll put this presentation up on our main district site. And so if you actually click out to look at it, you will actually be able to go and see this information. All right. So that's the first step. It's probably a lot longer than you wanted to come up. It's a big topic. I felt like there wasn't any anything.
Questions yet.
Yeah. Do you have any questions before we go to the fun stuff? Technology gets ideas. There you go.
So Chromebooks, by their essence, are really basic. So what do you look for then? Well, there's a variety of brands, and I can't necessarily give information about each one specifically. I will tell you in the district, we use Samsung brand. We've had really great luck with them. They seem to be built very well, but I'm sure that any of these others, you would probably find the same. I'll tell you from an internal component mechanism, a lot of these pieces are made anymore, manufactured by the same company. So honestly, it's really more about what you like, how much you want to spend, what features are included in it. The only thing you really have to be aware of, and I apologize, is that easy to read. There's two things for a Chromebook that you really want to look at, and that's the processor speed, which referred to as the CPU, and the RAM. And I wouldn't do any less than 4 gig on RAM. You'll probably find 2 gig and 4 gig. 2 gig might be a little bit cheaper, but I don't recommend doing anything under 4. And as far as a processor standpoint, that's just basically how fast the machine processes information. And without getting too technical, and if anybody has specific questions, feel free to email me. There's really two main types of processors, Intel and AMD. Intel's probably the most popular, but it's also much more expensive than AMD. But that doesn't mean AMD's not good if, you're getting it for the right price point. And so you can't, there's another thing, there's single processors, dual processors. You can't just look at the speed as a comparison. You have to look at the processor type. And is it a single, is it a dual, is it a quad processor? Because a quad processor can have a speed listed lower than a single processor, but be faster because it's a quad processor. I know I got way tuned into that for you.
Dr. Myers, if you were buying a Chromebook for an eighth grader, what would you recommend? Because you just said all that and everybody's going, separate from the brand, which I understand, is unique and you can pick, these are all the same.
It depends and it varies as to when they're manufactured, right?
Oh.
But the basic Samsung model is the one that I would probably use as a comparison. If you look up the Samsung version of the Chromebook, and I believe it's the Chromebook 3, okay? It's 4 gig of RAM. I would use that as your base. Okay? I don't know, and again, it depends on when they're manufactured. So you'd have to look at it. There's even sites that you can plug in and compare processors, CPU comparison. If you have specific questions, please feel free to email me. I'll tell you what, Best Buy is great if you go there at explaining and kind of giving you a comparison. I'll tell you what else a lot of sites do is they give the ability to compare models and so you can see those variations and differences. But a Chromebook 3 for Samsung, I would use as your basis. Because that's what we bought this past year, and that's good. Now, I'll tell you, you can buy a touchscreen, and maybe your child wants that, and that's great. That's going to cost you a little bit more. You can buy colors, again, cost a little bit more, but if that's a feature you want. But the basic operation of a Chromebook is a Chromebook is a Chromebook. Okay? It's just all those other pieces that you can add to it that'll drive the price up. But you can get a good Chromebook for $170. $170. If you start getting to $100, I would probably say it's maybe because we're trying to get rid of 2 gig RAM models, things like that. So processor and RAM are the two things you really want to look at when you're doing a comparison. Use the Chromebook 3 as your basis. Okay, here's one. How many of you are familiar with the GoPro camera? The camera that you can put on your head or on your bike or whatever and captures all your action. Okay, well here it is in a kid version. It's called the VTech Kitty Zoom Action Cam. So for $40, you basically can get your kid a GoPro camera that they can put onto their bike and video and do a lot of cool things. So I won't play the video because I know we're running out of time. There's actually one video I really do want to show you for Twitter. I think it's really cool. So this is just something I threw out just because I know GoPros are extremely popular. So this is a great alternative for younger kids. Oh, the Amazon Fire HD Kids tablet. Okay, so again, tablets are extremely popular, especially at home use when you want something a little bit bigger than your phone. And maybe you're just not to that point where you're ready to fight off the bullet on the iPad because they are a little bit expensive. Amazon Fire makes a great tablet for kids, which has a 2-year worry-free guarantee. You watch the video, the kid's spilling milk on it and doing all kinds of crap to it. You basically just rinse it off and you're good to go. So it's a great tool for the younger kids for $100. I kind of went in sequence of age with these, except I did the Chromebooks first because it was probably one of the more popular ones I guess. Oh, UMaster virtual reality. This is something we are just starting to delve into in the district. We bought our first 2 sets of Google Expedition kits this year that we're actually going to be using. They actually use this exact UMaster viewer. You do have to have a cell phone that you use this with, and it has to fit into this, so you're going to want to look at the specs on here. But essentially, it allows the kids to kind of use these to delve into like a virtual reality screen. And again, there's a video on here that I posted stuff online. You can look at it. That allows them to see. They can move all around and look all around. Maybe a historical landmark or something of that nature. It's not moving. Okay, it's still, but it's a 3D image that you can shift and move around. There's also a sort of a grown-up version of this. Samsung is now touting and advertising a lot. Samsung here, the only thing with this is it has to be a Samsung device. The ViewMaster will work with both iPhones or Android-based devices, but the Samsung gear is specific to Samsung. So just something to consider. And again, I have a video up there that you can look at it online. Oh, this is the one I really wanted to show you a video of. This one I thought was so cute. It's an interactive robotic toy. And it'll probably just be best if you just watch the video on it. Thank you.
relatively new startup company, but there's more videos online that show more interaction, and it's really a neat tool. 3D printing is something else that we're just breaking into in the district, and now we're starting to sell home 3D printers. This Da Vinci printer by XYZ Printing is one of the ones that have just been released. Mattel was supposed to have one, and it actually got pushed back, so it made a lot of news because it was supposed to be ready for this Christmas, and it is not. So this is one. It starts at $250. They have different models. There's a, you know, the beginner, there's a junior, and it's actually a home 3D printer that you're 15 years, and we are using those across the district. If you've heard or your kids have been involved in that, K-12, we have classes that incorporate STEM principles that our students that go to and use these. Okay, I don't know how many of you have heard of drones, okay? They make the news all the time, and probably most recently now, because there's a lot of really strict FAA regulations on them. Now they're saying, like, you can't fly a drone unless you are, like, licensed and have FAA clearance and whatnot. So this I thought was neat because it's a nano drone. You can see it's probably only about 2 to 3 inches. And there's no FAA regulation with this because of the size and the distance that it's able to go. So if you do have a student who's really, really into this type of activity, this is a great alternative. And again, this site has multiple versions of this in different variations, so I have a link there. This is just one of them. Oh, you have any shower singers? Do you have any shower singers? This is a great little speaker for putting in the shower. It plays off your phone, right? So you have to have your phone in the bathroom with you, which what kid doesn't come to the bathroom without their phone, right? And you can answer your phone. You can answer your phone through this and have a conversation while you're in the shower because you can't miss, right, that phone call that you're getting from someone. So this is a great option. It's only $20. And it has a little suction cup too on the back of the wall. Okay, along with the Kitty Zoom V-Tech camera, this is sort of maybe a junior high, senior high version. If you don't want to go to the cost of a GoPro, this is what they call the Polaroid Q. It's $150. You can see it mounted here on his helmet. You can, they actually need to show a number of kids with it. So again, you have to have a device with it, right, to play back the content. But essentially, it's just a recording device that you can attach to anything and use. So again, it's a GoPro alternative. Oh, don't faint when you see the price of these, but I'm going to tell you, kids use these, get them. It's astounding to me that you pay this much money for a headphones, but they do. Anybody have these for your kids? Yeah. I don't know. They claim it's the clarity, it's the sound, it's whatever. Beats is a big brand. They have their Solo 3 wireless headphones around $250. But then they also, if you have kids that like the in-ear time, there's the Bose, which is a quiet comfort in-ear. Both of them range from $250 to $300. They cost more than your Chromebook you're buying. The headphones to listen to the content. Fitbit, always a great option, right? It has all kinds of variations. This one's on the list this year as a hot Christmas item. It's called the Volta. Why? I think because it's a little more stylish than the other Fitbit versions. You need different colors and a lot of accessories that come with it. So it's just a new, newer version of Fitbit. Oh, and smartwatches. Big on all fronts. You have the Apple brand over here. You have Samsung. And you even actually have Fossil Q. And Fossil Q is platform independent, so it works with iPhone or Samsung. And what's cool about it is it looks like it's just a regular watch. Looks like a regular watch, but when your phone rings with a message, it'll come up on the screen so you can see it. So these also kind of have a little bit of fitness tracking ability in them, but really it's just kind of keep your pulse on your phone if you're in a meeting and you know you keep your phone put away, but now you got it on your watch, right? So you just come look down and see if somebody texts you. So those are kind of big and very popular right now. Well, this I just wanted to bring up. This is Amazon. Amazon has, I didn't get these items necessarily off this list, but just in my searching, what I thought was actually interesting about this holiday toilet, look at the they have obviously the top 100, they have tech toys. It does have STEM picks, which I thought was really good, because that's a real big buzzword in education right now, STEM education, which stands for science, technology, engineering, and math. And those are the skills we're really trying to focus in on our kids, problem solving, and creative thinking, things of that nature. We've also seen it as STEAM, with the art added, and there's all kinds of variations of it. But I just thought it was interesting that Amazon actually had that as a category, so if you're really looking for something specific to that, you can find it. And that's it. And that is my email. So if anybody has any specific questions, my phone number's there as well. Please feel free to reach out to me. I'll be happy to help in any way that I can, give you guidance or suggestions. I don't ever like to say, you know, one way is right or wrong about doing something, but it really is all dependent upon your individual needs. But please feel free to reach out to me. Again, we'll be